And when users approach us on the Slack channel or have questions, the number one question we have, did you install Scylla Grafana monitoring? So if you hadn't, please do. But a lot of users don't do it till they have an issue. And my session is about why you should use Scylla Grafana monitoring when you develop your application and what it allows you or will allow you while you're developing your application. So Scylla exposes a lot of metrics, hundreds of metrics. A lot of them have to do with how Scylla ticks, internal parts of Scylla, how they interact with. Others have to do with how Scylla interacts with your hardware. Is it working well? Do we have any queues filing up? Are we getting any delays from the hardware? Another subset has to do with the cluster. How is the cluster doing? Again, we're running a distributed database, so a query will end up in probably in more than one node. But a subset of those has to do with how good you've written your application and how good you've set it up to work with Scylla. So my session will be focused around these metrics and a bit about data modeling. So for the sake of this session, I've written a sample application. And the sample application is written in Go. It's following the GoSQL example, so I didn't create any new issues. I just copy code and extended it a bit. And it's normal. When you start off, you copy code from somewhere and start augmenting it for whatever you want. The question is, did you catch all the items that you should have fixed before you go on to production? And there is a cost when you catch it. If you catch those things earlier on, instead of building strings using prepared statements, it's much easier to fix at the beginning. So again, that's my application. But a side note, I'm not a Go developer. Or to quote Hendrik that made it Go-ish, it looks like a C++ developer hacked some code in Go just to show something. So I apologize if it's not that slick to the Go developers, but it's already up. And the sample application is based on two different tables. There is a tweets table in which we insert the tweets, and there is a timeline table into which we insert the information the user is interested in. So if I'm following a user, my timeline will have the tweets coming for that user. We added an additional field called liked, in which I can mark tweets that I'm interested in or liked. And again, for each user tweet, we insert into the tweets table, and that is a statement. For each follower of a user, we enter it into the tweets timeline of that follower. In the sample application, we have a single query in which we're reading from the timeline and reading only the top, the first 50 lines, or the last 50 events. The setup, so the sample app starts with four nodes, a single client, a single cluster. And let's get it running. So I have here a four-node cluster running in Docker, not yet with Docker Compose, but it will be. And let's start the client. So I've created a new dashboard. This is not yet live. It's part of the sample app. We'll probably propagate it later to the default dashboards. But this dashboard shows how good your application is running. So starting from the left, let's start tackle items. And what we see here is only 1% of the requests are prepared statements. So I'm going to stop this. And to make it easy for me, can we switch over to your display, please? And the pointer is not working. So what I show here is that 1% of the requests are prepared statements, and then you have the numbers. So let's fix that. And to get the gauge into green, 100% of your requests need to be a prepared statement. And why is that? So when you're sending a string to Scylla, which holds the request, Scylla needs to parse it. It needs to figure out which table you're accessing. It needs to find the columns that you're inserting into. It needs to validate that the query is correct. It needs to extract the values from the columns. So all of this repetitive work is something that is happening in each request. And that is saved when you're doing prepared statements. This parsing and building of a template is done only once for the prepared statement. And afterwards, you can reuse that. In addition to that, again, if you're after getting the best performance that you can, you're actually hurting yourself. This additional processing is costing you time. So we are doing processing and then doing the statement itself. And that adds latency. On top of it, it doesn't allow us to do optimal routing. So in step two of the application, we're changing. We're changing the prepared statement from being a simple built string into a prepared statement in which we're building the template and then passing the arguments. In GoSQL, that's the simplest form I found. Okay, so instead of switching back and forth, and for the essence of this talk, only the first step I'll do on my computer, the rest are screenshots. So when we fix this, we got the first gouge prepared statements into 100%, but then we have the token aware, and that is only at 74%. So out of my requests being sent, 26% are not hitting the correct coordinator. And if we want to look at this, the client is sending a prepared statement, but is not sending it to the right node. It's sending it to a coordinator that is not a replica. That node that received the request doesn't have the data. It needs to relay that request to other nodes in the cluster. And that's, of course, an additional hop, an additional unneeded processing. So in step three of the sample application, we are fixing this. And the way to do it in GoSQL is to define a host selection policy. And we have here the token aware host policy that is defined. And once we set this up and run step three, everything is green. Great. So we're very happy. It was very simple. We fixed two small issues.